Hello everyone, let me check if the stream is coming up in YouTube or not. After that, let's start with the class. Okay. Okay. The stream is coming up in YouTube, everyone. Okay. Hello everyone, welcome to Unacademy's YouTube channel. Today we are going to look at current affairs topics that are important for the upcoming prelims examination. Okay, now before going on to the topic itself, let me give you a brief introduction about myself as well as about Unacademy. See, my name is Arvind. I completed my BE Mechanical Engineering in 2014 and I have almost 3 years of experience in teaching UPSC Civil Services, and I have experienced all stages of UPSC Civil Services, that is prelims, mains as well as interview. Now my specialty subjects include polity, international relations as well as current affairs. Now if you want to know more about the schedule of my classes, when I'm about to take my classes, or if you want to know, if you want to ask doubts regarding my classes, you can join this group unacademy_aravind, where I will update my schedule regularly. Now what will you get by subscribing to Unacademy? See, by subscribing to Unacademy, we'll get access to daily live classes where you get to watch those classes, you can re-watch them, and importantly you can ask doubts then and there itself. And importantly, this rewatchability feature is very, very important. Why? Because if you are going for an offline institution, there you cannot re-watch your classes again, but here in Unacademy you can re-watch those classes because it's an online class. Okay, so that will help you in case if you have any doubts regarding your past classes, or if you want to revisit your old classes, this rewatchability feature will be very helpful for you. And then Unacademy conducts live tests as well as quizzes almost on a daily basis, so that students can test themselves based on examination point of view. And then all courses in Unacademy are structured courses, so that the learning process for the students becomes much, much easier. And then you will get unlimited access to videos concerned with a particular examination that you're subscribing for. So for example, if you're subscribing for UPSC examination, you will get unlimited access to videos concerned with UPSC examination. Okay. And Unacademy serves as a platform where top educators like Sudarshan Gujjar, Roman Saini, Ayush Sanghi, all these top educators, they get to share their knowledge with students who hail from all over India. Okay, so that's another job that Unacademy is doing. And then Unacademy covers syllabus in a very comprehensive manner, so that every nook and corner of UPSC syllabus will be covered by Unacademy. Not only that, the same syllabus will be covered by multiple faculties, so that if you are not satisfied with one faculty, you can immediately switch over to another faculty for the same syllabus. Okay. And then I suggest you guys download Unacademy learning app, so that you can keep a better track of your learning goals, how much time you are spending with Unacademy, or if your favorite teacher is about to take class in Unacademy, you will get an immediate notifications if you are doing downloading Unacademy learning app. Okay. Now these are the amounts that Unacademy will charge you for a plus subscription. Okay. Now this amount is very, very less compared to offline institutions, where you will be spending upwards of 4 to 5 lakh rupees on things like fees, food, rent. But with Unacademy, not only the upfront cost is very, very less, but you will be saving a lot on food as well as rent, because you'll be learning from the comfort of your home itself. Now on top of very meager sum that Unacademy is charging you, if you're using my code ARAVINGV, you will get 10% as offer. Okay, so instead of paying 44,000 rupees for 12 months, you'll be paying only 39,600 rupees. Now I always suggest students to either go for 1 year or 2 year, because if you are trying to prepare for UPSC, minimum it will take 2 years for preparation. Now for preparation it will take 1 year, but for clearing UPSC itself it will take 2 years. So okay, it will take a lot of time to prepare and clear UPSC. So either go for 1 year or 2 year, which will be more beneficial for you, because you will be paying a lot less per month compared to lesser month subscription plans. Okay. Now, UnAcademy has also another type of platform called as Iconic Platform, where UnAcademy will assign you with a personal coach. This personal coach is an experienced faculty in UPSC field. Okay. And then this experienced faculty is somewhere we will clear UPSC itself, so they know all about how to clear UPSC, and they also know how what kind of struggles will students face when they are trying to clear UPSC. All these things they know. Okay, so if you are facing any troubles or if you want any guidance, this personal coach will guide you through that process, and this personal coach will also monitor your progress day by day. Okay, how you are improving, or if you are not improving, they will suggest you some ways to improve your output. All these things they will do, and then UnAcademy will also give you with a daily mains question and answer practice. Okay, this daily split, this is very important from the examination point of view, because now many students, they will study only from the prelims point of view. They will omit mains, but that's a wrong strategy. They have to prepare both for prelims as well as mains, and then UnAcademy will give you with a study planner, and then they will give you personalized feedback based on your performances in tests. Now, even here, if you're using the code ARAVINDV, you will get 10% as offer. Okay, so don't forget to use my code ARAVINDV, people. Okay, you will get 10% as offer. Okay. Now, these are the topics that we're going to look today. Okay, the topics that we are going to look today is, the first one is sub-classification of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, animal husbandry infrastructure development fund, farmer producer organizations, draft environmental impact assessment of 2020, autonomous bodies, impact of BT cotton, World Solar Technology Summit, and then Rojan Art Gujarat. Okay, so these are the topics that we are going to look today. Okay. Now, the first topic is subclassification of scheduled castes and scheduled tribe. See here, if you look at the central government jobs, okay, jobs are reserved in the basis of general, OBC, scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. Okay, but if you look at the reason for why we are giving reservation is to provide representation for disadvantaged sections of the Indian population. But if you look at within this subclassification itself, some categories of SCs are more wealthy compared to other categories of SC, and similar to that, some categories of ST are more wealthy compared to other categories of ST. Okay, so within that classification itself, there is a lot of disparity of income as well as status between OBC, ST and ST groups. Okay, so to solve this problem, Supreme Court has held that states can subclassify scheduled caste as well as OBCs for the purpose of reservation. Now, Supreme Court has held that states can have subgroups among scheduled castes, scheduled tribes for the sake of reservation. Okay. Now, why was this topic in news? Because Supreme Court, a 5-judge bench of Supreme Court held that states can subclassify SCs and STs in central list. Okay. Who will classify scheduled castes and scheduled tribes? Okay. Central government, National Commission for Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe, they will classify, they will have a central list. In this central list, they will specify who, which caste will belong to Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe. Okay, so it's the Supreme Court has said that states, central government and state government, they can subclassify this Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes which are mentioned in central list to provide preferential treatment to certain scheduled castes over others to ensure equal representation. Now, earlier in 2005, E.V. Chennaiya was the state of Andhra Pradesh and others. Even in this case, there was a 5-judge bench in Supreme Court which ruled that only president has a power to notify the inclusion or exclusion of caste as a scheduled caste, and states cannot tinker with this list. Okay, so this recent order is an amendment to the previous order. Okay, now central list of scheduled caste and scheduled tribes is notified by the president under Article 342 and 341 and 342 respectively. Now, court in a recent judgment said that subclassifications within central list does not amount to tinkering with it. States only give preference to weakest in a pragmatic manner based on statistical data. Okay. Now, since a bench of equal strength, that is 5 judges in this case, cannot overrule a previous decision, court have referred into a larger bench. Okay, since the earlier judgment, in 2005, the judgment was given by 5 judge bench. Now, even the recent one was given by 5 judge bench. Okay, so since equal number of judges cannot overrule a previous judgment, this decision has been deferred to a larger bench. Okay, so when it has been deferred to a larger bench, Supreme Court now they will try to establish a 7 judge bench. Okay, now the court in its recent order also said that reservation for weaker sessions was not contemplated by the constitution makers in perpetuity, and the constitution goal of social transformation cannot be achieved without taking into account of changing social realities. Now, what is this changing social realities? The changing social reality means that some sections of scheduled tribes and scheduled castes, they are becoming more powerful, they are becoming more, how to say, well-to-do compared to other scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. Okay. Now, apart from that, there is a subcategorization of other backward classes as well. Now, why was this issue in news? Because recently the Union Cabinet approved the term extension of commission to examine the issue of subcategorization of other backward classes. Now, who are OBCs? See, OBC is a collective term used by the government to classify castes which are educationally or socially disadvantaged. OBCs are vastly heterogeneous groups. These are various jatis or subcastes which vary significantly in the societal and economic status. For instance, OBCs include landowning communities in both North India as well as South India, alongside poorer sections of the society living on subsistence labor. Okay, so within OBCs itself, some sections of OBCs are well-to-do, they have land with them, but some sections of OBCs are very poor and they live on daily wage and they follow subsistence labor. Okay, so to accommodate these different sections of OBCs, subcategorization of OBCs is being recommended. Now, the Union Government constituted a 4-member commission headed by Justice G. Rohini in 2017 under Article 340 with the aim to improve the equitability of sharing of benefits among OBCs. Now, the Article 340 of Indian Constitution lays down conditions for the appointment of commission to investigate the conditions of backward classes. Now, what is the mandate of this commission? Examining the extent of equitable distribution of benefits of reservation, that is 27% of reservation in jobs and education among castes or communities with reference to central OBC list. Work out the mechanism, criteria, norms and parameters in a scientific approach of subcategorization of OBCs. So this is the mandate of this commission. Okay. Now let's look take a look at some background information on Mandal Commission. Now in 1990, the then Union Government announced that other backward classes would get 27% reservation in jobs in central government services and public sector units under Article 16, Clause 4 of the Constitution. Okay. Now the decision was made based on Mandal Commission report, which was set up in 1979, which was chaired by B.P. Mandal. Okay. Now the mandate of this Mandal Commission was to identify socially, educationally backward classes to address a caste discrimination. Now the recommendation of OBC reservation in central government institution was implemented in 1992, while the education quota came into force in 2006 under Article 15, Clause 4 of the Constitution. Now, to ensure that benefits of the recommendations of Mandal Commission percolated down to the most backward communities, the creamy layer criteria was invoked by the Supreme Court in the ruling called as Indira Swani judgment. Okay. Now, a household with an annual income of 8 lakh or above is classified as belonging to creamy layer among OBCs. Hence, this creamy layer OBCs, they are not eligible for reservation. Okay, that's the judgment given in Indira Swani judgment. Now let's take a look at this idea of subcategorization. See, the first backward class commission report of 1955 had proposed a subcategorization of OBCs into backward and extremely backward communities. In the Mandal Commission report of 1979, a dissent note by a member L.R. Nayak proposed a subcategorization in intermediate and depressed backward classes. In 2015, the National Commission for Backward Classes has proposed that OBCs be divided into the three following categories: extremely backward classes or EBC group A. Now this group will face social, education and economic backwardness even within the OBCs. This OBC list will consist of aboriginal tribes, nomadic and semi-nomadic tribes who have been carrying on with their traditional occupations. Okay. The next one is more backward classes. They consist of occasional groups carrying on with their traditional occupations, and backward classes group C comprising of those comparatively more forward. Okay. So these are three types of subcategorization of OBCs which was recommended by 2015 NPC National Commission for Backward Classes report. Now, according to National Commission for Backward Classes, 11 states such as Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Puducherry, Karnataka, Haryana, Jharkhand, West Bengal, Bihar, Maharashtra, Rajasthan and Tamil Nadu have subcategorized OBCs for reservation in state government-owned institutions. Okay. So these 11 states have subcategorized OBCs into OBCs, most backward classes. So they have subcategorized to provide reservation in government jobs. Now let's take a look at National Commission for Backward Classes. See, until now, under Article 338, it was National Commission for Scheduled Caste that addressed the grievances of OBCs. Okay. Now the present National Commission for Backward Classes, set up under the National Commission of Backward Classes Act of 1993, as Article 338B of Indian Constitution, can only recommend inclusion and exclusion of OBC list, okay, castes from OBC list, and the level of income that cuts off creamy layer among these castes from the benefits of reservation. Okay, so this National Commission for Backward Classes, set up under 1993 National Commission for Backward Classes Act, it had only two mandates. One is to recommend inclusion and exclusion of castes from OBC list. Another one is to recommend the income layer. Okay, so to mandate a cutoff for a creamy layer. Okay. Now recently the 123rd Constitution Amendment Bill or 102nd Constitution Amendment Act aims to provide constitutional status to National Commission for Backward Classes. This will give powers akin to socially economically backward classes commission. Okay, the functions performed by National Commission for Scheduled Castes will be now transferred to the new National Commission for Backward Classes. Now the amendment also brings about changes in Article 342A as well as Article 336. Article 342A relates to central list of socially and educationally backward classes. Article 366 contains the definition used in the Constitution unless specifically stated otherwise. Now under this bill, the National Commission for Backward Classes will comprise of 5 members who will be appointed by the President. Their tenure and conditions of service will also be decided by the President. Now, what are the key functions performed by this National Commission for Backward Classes? In case of grievances related to non-implementation of reservations, economic grievances, violence, etc., people will be able to move the commission. Now, this bill gives proposed commission the power to inquire into complaints of deprivation of rights and safeguards. This amendment then also gives the power of civil court trying a suit and allows it to summon anyone required documentation to produce and receive evidence on an affidavit. Okay, so National Commission for Backward Classes is a quasi-judicial body. Okay, so according to this, National Commission for Backward Classes is a quasi-judicial body. Now, the next topic that we are going to look today is Animal Husbandry Infrastructure Development Fund. Now, why was this topic in news? Because, see, recently Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs has recently approved the establishment of Animal Husbandry Infrastructure Development Fund worth of almost ₹15,000 crores. So, let's take a look at some information about Animal Husbandry Infrastructure Development Fund. See, Animal Husbandry Infrastructure Development Fund would facilitate investments in establishment of infrastructure for dairy and meat processing and establishment of animal feed plant in the private sector. Now, implementing agency for this particular fund is Department of Animal Husbandry, Dairy and Fisheries. Now, some eligible beneficiaries for this fund is farmer producer organizations, micro small medium enterprises, not for profit companies, private companies and individual entrepreneurs. Now what are the activities which are eligible? Which of the following activities are eligible for this? One is dairy processing, value added dairy product manufacturing, meat processing, etc. Now what is the funding required? What is the funding required for this particular project? Minimum 10% margin money to be contributed by the beneficiary. The balance 90% would be loan component to be made available by the scheduled banks. Okay. Now interest subvention. Government of India will provide 3% interest subvention to eligible beneficiaries. Okay, the government of India will provide 3% interest subvention to eligible beneficiaries. So if the interest charged by the bank is 10%, the you will be paying only 7% interest rate. The rest 3% will be assumed by the government. Okay. Now credit guarantee fund. Government of India would also set up credit guarantee fund of almost 750 crores to be managed by NABARD. Now this credit guarantee would be provided to those sanctioned projects which are covered under micro small medium enterprises defined CV. Okay. So that's it everyone. If you have any doubts so far, please ask your doubts. I will give you 1 minute to ask your doubts. After that I am moving on to the next topic. Okay. Please ask your doubts. After that I am moving on to the next topic. Okay everyone, I have given you ample amount of time to ask your doubts. Okay, so the next topic that we are going to look at is farmer producer organization. Now why was this topic in news? Recently, operational guidelines for farmer and promotion of FPOs was released. Now what were the key guidelines under this guidelines? One is eligibility. A farmer producer organization with a minimum farmer member size of 300 in plains while 100 in northeastern and hilly areas including such other areas of union territories. Now the next one is formation and promotion of farmer producer organization is based on produce cluster area. PCA is a geographical area where produce of almost similar nature is grown. The next one is National Project Management Agency will be set up for providing overall project guidance, monitoring, etc. Next one is implementing agencies. Small Farmers Agribusiness Consortium, National Cooperative Development Corporation and NABARD. Also state and union territories can have its own implementing agencies. Okay. Next one is cluster based business organizations at central and cluster level to form and promote farmer producer organizations. Okay. Now the provisions for equity grant from the government to strengthen the financial base of farmer producer organizations. Now some related news regarding these farmer producer organizations. Ministry of Agriculture releases new guidelines on contract farming. Now the guidelines were issued under Farmers Empowerment and Protection Agreement on Price Assurance and Farm Services Ordinance of 2020. Ordinance was brought last month to provide a national framework on farming agreements that protects and empowers the farmers to engage with wholesalers, exporters or large retailers. Now this aims at facilitating contract farming where a private buyer contracts to purchase a crop at a certain price at the beginning of a season, transferring the risk of market unpredictability from the corporate from the farmer to corporate sector. Now what are the key guidelines regarding this contract farming? Okay. Now the first guideline is that the verbal agreements are not recognized and it should be written in local language. Why is this provision there? Because when an agreement is signed in English or something like that, farmers cannot understand this agreement. Okay. When farmers cannot understand the agreement, Okay, the terms, there will be some terms which will not be acceptable to the cultivator, but they will sign nonetheless. Okay, so that's it. That's why in this guidelines I have said that verbal agreements are not recognized and the written agreement should also be written in local language. Now the farming agreement should be for a minimum period of one cropping season until a maximum of 5 years. Now also this agreement should clearly indicate the nature of farming, size of land area and address of farmer, etc. And also agreement can be with the farmers having land title, farmer producer organization and also share cropper. Now sponsor would also be responsible for any loss or damage due to input supplied to farmers. And also farmers cannot use the inputs provided by the sponsor for anything other than growing the produce agreed upon. Now sponsor is not permitted to gain or enjoy ownership of rights. Okay, so these are the guidelines that have been issued by the central government with regards to farmer producer organization as well as contract farming. Okay, everyone, if you have any doubts regarding this topic, please ask right now. Okay, after that I will move on to the next topic. Okay, please ask your doubts. Now the next topic that we will discuss today is draft environmental impact assessment policy of 2020. Now why was this topic in news? See, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change has published this draft environment impact assessment notification of 2020, which replaces the existing environment impact assessment notification 2006, which was brought under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. Okay, so this environment impact assessment, it was issued based on Environment Protection Act of 1986. Okay, so what is this environment impact assessment of? What is this environment impact assessment? See, environment impact assessment or EIA is a process or study which predicts the effect of a proposed industrial infrastructural project on the environment. Now, this EIA prevents the proposed activity project from being approved without proper oversight or taking adverse consequences into account. Now, EIA also compares various alternatives for a project and seeks to identify the ones which represents the best combination of economic and environmental costs and benefits. Okay, so these are the three objectives of an environmental impact assessment. One is to predict the effect of a proposed industrial or infrastructure project on the environment. Okay, this prevents a proposed activity or project from being approved without proper oversight or taking adverse consequences into the account. And also it will compare, okay, it will compare alternatives for a project which will have a less impact on environment. Okay, so these are the three objectives of environment impact assessment. And also any project requiring environmental clearance first needs to undergo a thorough screening and scoping process by the regulatory authorities, and thereafter a draft EIA report is sent for public consultation. Now under the existing 2006 law, projects are categorized into category A and B, where all projects in category A need to undergo the process of EIA. Category B projects are further classified into category B1 and B2 on the basis of their scope and potential impact, and only the projects under B2 are exempted from cumbersome process of EIA. Now what is the related news regarding this EIA? Recently, National Green Tribunal set stringent conditions for commercial use of groundwater. There must be no general permission for withdrawal of groundwater, particularly to any commercial entity, without a proper environmental impact assessment for such activity. Now, permission to extract groundwater must be specified times and quantity of water, not for perpetuity. Annual review of permissions given to be conducted by independent and expert evaluation. Groundwater levels must be audited and recorded in compliance with the conditions given for the permission. Such audits must be published online as well. Okay, so this is some related news regarding environment impact assessment. Now let's compare various environment impact assessment, okay, which has been released over the years. Okay. Now, if you look at there have been three versions of intermittent patterns. One in 1994, one in 2006, one in 2020. Okay. Now, if you look at 1994 impairment impact assessment, the period for public consultation is for 30 days. For EIA, it is for 45 days. The reason what it is for 40 days. Okay. Now, the monitoring period for 1994, 1 year. The project authority is to monitor projects for compliance and environment norms for every 6 months. Now, even for environment impact assessment of 2006 notification, the projects will be monitored for 6 months. But in the recent notification, the monitoring period has been relaxed to 1 year. Okay, so the projects will be monitored every 1 year. Now, the next one is regarding environmental clearance. Now, the onus of providing environmental clearance for projects lay entirely on the central government. There was no division of categories for projects mentioned in Schedule 1 of the notification. Okay. Now, if you look at this 2006 notification, the power was decentralized, wherein the new notification, the onus of providing environmental clearance for projects was shared between central government and state government. Now, the projects in Schedule 1 of this notification were divided into two categories. One is Category A, another one is Category B. Now, national and state level environment impact assessment authority were responsible for it respectively. Now, if you look at the recent notification, the onus of providing environmental clearance for projects was divided between central and state government as before. The projects are divided into categories of A, B1 and B2 based on potential social environmental impacts and spatial extent of these impacts. Okay. So here the projects are categorized into A. Within B, they are further classified into B1 and B2. Now, environment clearance process for this 1994 notification. The first one is screening, public hearing, obtaining no objection certificate from the State Pollution and Control Board, evaluation of application and recommendation. This process has to be completed within 90 days. And if you look at the 2006 notification, the process is screening, scoping, public hearing, appraisal. Category A projects would have to mandatorily undergo environmental clearance and there is no screening process for it. Category B projects would have to undergo screening and to determine whether they belong to Category B1 or B2. Category B2 are exempted from EIA. Now, if you look at the recent notification, for Category A and B1 projects, okay, the process is like this: scoping, preparing draft report, public consultation, preparation of final EIA report and then appraisal. Now, Category B2 projects which require appraisal have to be placed before the appraisal committee, which are preparation and appraisal of environment management plan, verification of its completeness with the authority appointed, grant and rejection of clearance. Okay, this is the process that is being followed in B2 projects. Now, Category B2 which do not require appraisal would only have to follow the last two steps. Okay. Now, what are the provisions for appeal against the prior environment clearance? This appeal is not applicable in the 1994 notification. Even 2006 notification is not applicable. But in case of 2020 notification, an appeal can be made to National Green Tribunal against the prior environmental clearance. Okay. Okay, everyone, if you have any doubts so far, please ask your doubts. I will give you 1 minute to ask your doubts. After that, I will be moving on to the next topic. Okay. Please ask your doubts, everyone. After that, I will be moving on to the next topic. Okay, since you guys are not asking any doubts, I assume that you've understood everything, and then I'm moving on to the next topic, autonomous bodies. Now, recently, the Union Government has recently abolished the All India Handicrafts Board. Now, the board, Handloom Board and Powerloom Board, in consonance with the government's vision of minimum government and maximum governance, all these boards have been abolished. The Ministry of Textiles has also changed the status of 8 textile research associations into approved bodies instead of earlier affiliated bodies. Thereafter, the government withdrew the officials of the Ministry of Textiles from governing bodies of these textile associations. These are bold steps in achieving leaner government machinery and to introduce systematic rationalization of government bodies. Further, it was evident for quite some time now that despite a laid out administrative structure in autonomous bodies, there are a number of governance issues that need to be reviewed. Now, what are autonomous bodies? See here, autonomous bodies are set up whenever it is felt that certain functions need to be discharged outside of governmental setup with some amount of independence and flexibility with day-to-day interference of government machinery. Now, these autonomous bodies, they are set up by ministries or departments concerned with the subject matter, and they are funded through grants and aids, either fully or partially, depending on the extent which such institutes generate internal resources of their own. Now, these grants are regulated by Ministry of Finance through their instructions, as well as instructions related to power for creation of posts and etc. Now, they are mostly registered as societies under Societies Registration Act, and in certain cases, they have been set up as statutory institutions under provisions contained in various acts. Okay. Now, if you look at the functionality of autonomous bodies are major stakeholders in government functioning, as they are engaged in diverse activities ranging from formulating frameworks for policies, conducting research, and preserving cultural heritage, etc. Now, the apex administrative body of autonomous bodies is called as governing council or governing body, and this body is chaired by a minister or secretary of the respective ministry. Now, these autonomous bodies have specialized committees such as Purchase Committee, Works Committee, Finance Committee with nominated ministry officials. Now, these autonomous bodies are audited by Comptroller Audit General, and the annual reports is presented in the Parliament every year. Now, what are the issues with autonomous bodies? The first one is accountability. These bodies are funded by taxpayers' money. However, there have been complaints that they do not follow the policies of the government and are accountable, and they are not accountable in a way that government departments are. Even though senior ministry officials are required to attend autonomous bodies committee meetings, they mostly don't due to their busy schedule. Okay, these senior ministry officials, they nominate junior officials who often lack the jurisdiction to make meaningful decisions during these meetings. Now, the next one is some opaque recruitment policies. The exact count of these bodies is not known, with estimates ranging from 400 to 650. Autonomous bodies employ a considerable number of people. For example, the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, an autonomous body under the Ministry of Agriculture, has almost 17,000 employees. However, unlike the government and public sector undertakings in which the recruitment rules are uniform and the recruitment is done by a centralized body called a Staff Selection Commission, the Union Public Service Commission, there is no such body for such recruitments. As a result, the mode of recruitment and recruitment rules differs for each of these bodies, sometimes even across autonomous bodies within the same ministry itself. The next one is non-adherence to envisaged goal. Now, the boards have fallen into disuse and did not serve the purpose for which they were envisaged. Okay, those autonomous boards, they have fallen into disuse and they do not serve the purpose for which they have been envisaged. Also, these boards were merely advisory in nature, and they have failed to impact on influencing policy making decisions, while they have become vehicles of political patronage with the emergence of middleman culture that did not help in the interest of weavers. Okay. Now, the structure of these boards made room for a large number of non-official members to advise the government, and also there is no uniform auditing process. Okay. There is no uniform audit procedure for autonomous bodies, Some autonomous bodies are audited by Comptroller Audit General of India, whereas many are done by chartered accountants. Now, what is the way forward regarding these autonomous bodies? How can we reform these autonomous bodies? The first one is to establish a legal framework. A legal framework should be devised which defines the boundaries of its working, its autonomy, and various policies that it must follow. This will simultaneously help identify the numbers of autonomous bodies, and we will also regulate autonomous bodies as well. Okay. Now, the next one is comprehensive review process. Each ministry will need to undertake a comprehensive review of autonomous bodies under their jurisdiction. Now, autonomous bodies have outlived their cause for which they have been established, and they may need to be closed or merged with similar organization, or their memorandum should be altered as per their new charter. Okay. And then we should have a pan-India recruitment agencies. Now, to bring about uniformity in policies, a task force need to be set up under a pan-India agency such as SSE or UPSC. This will streamline the recruitment rules, salary structure, allowance and perks paid to employees and mode of recruitment. The next one is collaborated approach. To ensure the participation of ministry officials, committee meetings of similar autonomous bodies should be held together so that appropriate authorities could provide meaningful suggestions. Now, it is also alleged that most of the agenda items raised by autonomous bodies are routine in nature. This should be discouraged, and only the important policy issues that need the ministry's intervention should be taken up in such meetings. Okay. Now, the next one is uniform independent auditing. Audits of autonomous bodies should be undertaken by an independent agency. Comptroller Audit General had done exhaustive performance audit of autonomous bodies in 2016, highlighting gaps in their performance. Such theme-based audits should be done for other autonomous bodies as well. Okay. Now, what is the conclusion regarding this topic? Now, the conclusion is that all these years on, these autonomous bodies have remained the one official forum, however watered down, where voices and views of different stakeholders could be expressed directly to the government. Now, these autonomous bodies bring in diversity, and they can also shape government policies in a more inclusive way. Now, there is an urgent need to define these autonomous bodies properly to bring uniformity in their policies, facilitate senior officials of attendance in their meetings, and to seek independent audits as well. Okay. So that's it everyone with regards to this topic. Now, this is the main question regarding this question. This is this topic, okay? Autonomous bodies are very crucial for government's functioning. Plus, there is an urgent need to streamline these autonomous bodies. In the light of this statement, above statement, critically discuss the role of autonomous body and their governance issues. Okay. So how will you write this? How will you write this question? This is the paper. First, you have to write how autonomous bodies are crucial in government's functioning. You have to write that. After that, you have to write in what way the role of autonomous bodies is very important for governance of India. Okay. And how they are falling short. Okay. We have to discuss all these issues. Okay. Okay, so that's it everyone for this topic. If you have any doubts so far, please ask your doubts. Okay, I'll give you 1 minute to ask your doubts. After that, I'm moving on to the next topic. You will please ask your doubts. Okay, after that I will move on to the next topic. Okay. Some people, please ask your doubts, okay? Now, the next topic that we are going to do today is impacts of BT cotton. Now, genetically modified cotton, the plant containing pesticide gene from the bacteria Bacillus thuringiensis, have been grown in India for about 20 years now. This pesticide now produced in each BT plant cell ought to protect the plant from bollworm, thereby increasing yields and reducing insecticide spraying on the cotton plant. However, despite finding huge favor in India, the GM crop has brought only modest benefits according to several studies. Okay, now let's take a look at history of BT cotton. Now, cotton has been woven and used in India for thousands of years, right from Harappan civilization itself. Cotton fabric around 3000 BCE have been excavated in the ruins of Mohenjo-daro and archaeological findings in Mergar, Pakistan show that cotton was used in subcontinent as far back as 5000 BC. Now, much of the cotton cultivated until 20th century in India was of indigenous Desi variety, Gossypium arboreum. From 1990s onward, hybrid varieties of G. hirsutum were promoted. These hybrids cannot resist a variety of local pests and require more fertilizers and pesticides. Cotton suffers from plenty of infestation from moth pests such as pink bollworm and sap sucking pests such as aphids and mealybugs. Now, rising depths and reducing yields coupled with increasing insect resistance worsened the plight of cotton farmers. It was in this setting that BT cotton was introduced in India in 2002. Now let's take a look at adoption of BT cotton. According to Ministry of Agriculture, from 2005, adoption of BT cotton rose to 81% in 2007 and up to 93% in 2011. Many short duration studies examining BT cotton in early years pronounced that BT was a panacea for dwindling yields and pesticide expenses. Now, if you look at the question, has BT cotton been really successful? Now, if you look at the, there has been a discrepancy between yields and BT cover. Now, there are discrepancies between yield and deployment of BT cotton. For instance, BT acreage was only 3.4% of total cotton area in 2003. However, the increase in yield in 2003-04 was 61%. So it is not sufficient to credit this increase of yield to BT cotton for that. Similarly, BT coverage by 2005 was only 15.7%, but increasing in yield increases were over 90% were over 2002 levels. While BT cotton adoption corresponded to a drop in spraying of bollworms, the study states that the countrywide yield stagnated after 2007, even as far as more farmers began to grow BT. So it states that even with more number of farmers started growing BT, the yield of cotton has stagnated. Now, by 2018, yields were lower than in the years of rapid BT adoption. Now, many states' figure correspond to the same statistics as well. Individual state data are more helpful in understanding subnational trends. In Maharashtra, the yields climbed in the decade after 2000 with no change in rate of increase when BT cotton was introduced. In Gujarat, Andhra Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh as well, there was no correlation between the adoption of the variety and increase in yields. For instance, Gujarat's surge in cotton yields was 113% in 2003, even as BT cotton was used only for 5% of land under cotton. Similar findings are seen in Punjab, Haryana and Rajasthan, where yield increase is incongruous with the spread of BT cotton. Now, another issue with India is that India has a low productivity for cotton. India's productivity yield per unit area is much lower than other major cotton producing countries. This means that a larger area is used for cotton production and hence BT cotton has failed to increase its yield. Okay. The next one is regarding market capture. Commercial BT hybrids have overshadowed the market, accompanied by the rollback of public sector cotton seed production. Hence, the Indian cotton farmers are left with little no choice but to use BT hybrid seed produced by private seed companies. The next one is regarding farmers' distress. Due to a combination of high input and high risk, Agricultural distress is extremely high among hybrid cotton cultivating farmers. Compact varieties, that is plant sown in high density for small period of time, would have significantly reduced this distress as well as increasing the yield. Now, what is the way forward regarding this issue? What is the way forward regarding BT quota? The first one is impact assessment. Before extending the GM technology to increase food crop yield, we must mandatorily assess the impact on livelihood, agrarian distress, etc. Hence, the outcome of deploying technology must be evaluated in a particular context. The technology does not prioritize the needs of principal stakeholders, that is farmers. It can have a significant negative fallout, especially in India, which has high proportion of marginal and subsistence farmers. Now, the next one is change in cropping pattern. There are two patterns of cotton plantation. One is compact and short term, where the plant is sown at high density for a small period of time. The other is for longer duration and that not that dense. India prefers longer duration with less density method. However, hybrids in India are bushy, long duration and planted at tenfold lower density. But cotton is a dryland crop and 65% of area under cotton in India is rain fed. Farmers with insufficient access to groundwater in these areas are entirely dependent upon rain. Hence, the shorter duration variety has major advantage as it reduces dependence on irrigation and drift. Now, particularly late in growing season where soil moisture drops following monsoon's withdrawal. Now, this period is when bolls develop and water requirement is the highest. And also, we should focus on indigenous breeds. Before the advent of British India, different varieties of cotton indigenously developed over a longer period of time were grown in different parts of the country, each being suited to local soil, water and climate. Now, Indian cotton fabrics dominated the world trade during succeeding millennia and they were exported to many places including Greece, Rome, Persia, Egypt, Assyria and many parts of Asia. The cost of ignoring Desi varieties for decades have been high for India. Now, these varieties resist many pests and they don't present the problems faced with hybrids. Research suggests that with pure line cotton varieties, high density planting and short season plants, cotton yields in India can be good and can stand a better chance at withstanding the vagaries of climate change as well. Now, government backing for resources, infrastructure and seeds is essential to scale up Desi varieties. Okay. So that's it everyone, with regards to the issue of BT cotton. Okay. So if you look at this BT cotton myriad controversy, ever since its introduction in India, BT cotton has faced severe opposition on the basis of its environment and health implications. Though there are no conclusive evidence for the same and the dominance of Monsanto, which has created us about BT cotton seeds. Now in March of 2016, the government decided to cap the price of Bolgar 2 seeds at 800 per 450 gram bag. It was been selling at 832,000 in different states, and also the royalty paid to Mako Monsanto Biotech is 49 per packet compared to 184 earlier. After which Monsanto threatened to exit the country. Months later, Bayer G announced it would acquire Monsanto. Now Monsanto withdrew its application seeking the approval of new herbicide tolerant BT cotton seed. But according to a report, 35 lakh pockets of hybrid cotton variety seeds worth 470 crores have been sold illegally in 2017-18. State governments are looking into the issue as well. Now, the cotton yields are expected to be 10% less in 2018 than the previous year because of pink bollworm infestation, though the production could be 11% more due to increased acreage. Now, over the last 3 years, reports have emerged of the pink bollworm becoming immune to Bolgar 2 variety. The Maharashtra government estimates that 80% of cotton area is affected by pink bollworms, though the extent of damage is still being studied. Okay, so this is the impact of BT cotton. So even though this BT cotton has been introduced in Indian agriculture, Indian farmers have not seen comparative advantage in their cultivation. Now the next, this is the main question regarding this topic everyone. Despite finding a huge favor in India, the GM crop has brought only modest benefits. In the light of the statements, critically analyze the use and impact of hybrid currencies in India. Okay, so this is a mains question, and you can write this mains question and send it to post this mains question in our Telegram group, and I will evaluate this mains question and then I will give you feedback. Okay. Now, if you have any doubts regarding these topics, please ask your doubts everyone. After that, I will move on to the next topic. Okay. People, if you have any doubts, please ask your doubts. Okay. After that, I am moving on to the next topic. Ask your doubts, everyone. Please ask your doubts. If you are people, please ask your doubts. Okay, please ask your doubts. Okay. Now the next topic that we are going to discuss is World Technology Summit. Now why was this topic in news? Now this topic was in news because recently the first ever World Solar Technology Summit was organized by the International Solar Alliance and the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry. Now what are the key points regarding this summit? Now the objective is to showcase to member countries the state of the art and next gen solar technologies that are available worldwide, to give an opportunity to decision makers and stakeholders to meet and discuss their own priorities and strategic agenda towards a larger integration, to discuss the recent highlights of solar technologies, cost-wise, technology-wise, technology transfers, challenges and concerns in the field. Now, what are the steps taken by India in this regard? In spite of having one of the lowest per capita carbon emissions in the world, India has pressed ahead with the deployment of renewable energy at a fast pace of lowering carbon footprints. India has enhanced its installed renewable capacity by almost 2.5 times and increased the solar installed capacity by more than 13 times. Now, globally, India ranks fourth in terms of renewable power. India has scaled non-fossil fuel-based power generations to 134 gigawatts, which is about 35% of total power generation. And it is expected to increase to about 220 gigawatts up by 2022. Now, India is providing capacity building support to ISA member countries through its Indian Technology and Economic Cooperation Program. Now, project preparation facility has been set up to develop bankable solar projects in ISA member countries with the help of Export-Import Bank of India. Now, in 2019, India has announced about $1.4 billion worth of lines of credits for covering 27 solar projects across 15 countries. These projects are in various stages of implementation. Now, what are the schemes that are related to solar energy? Now, solar energy has taken center place in India's National Action Plan for Climate Change, with National Solar Mission as one of its key missions. Now, National Solar Mission was launched on 11th of January 2010 and is in line with India's intended nationally determined contributions. Now, this objective is to establish India as a global leader in solar energy by creating the policy conditions for solar technology diffusion across the country as quickly as possible. The next scheme that India is implementing is One Earth, One World, One Grid. India's ambitious cross-border power grid plan, which seeks to transfer power generation in one region to feed electricity demand of others. So in this scheme, if India is generating solar power and if India has surplus power, India will export this surplus power to other regions. Okay, so they are trying to mismatch the demand supply disparities. The next is Kusum scheme. It aims to replace the use of diesel in farm sector with solar energy, with a target of solarization of 2.8 million irrigation pumps. The next one is Solar Charka mission. It is an enterprise driven scheme and envisages setting up of solar charka clusters, which will have 200 to 2042 beneficiaries. These solar chakras are operated using solar power, keeping the environment clean and generating sustainable employment for the artisans. Now, 750 megawatt solar project, which has been inaugurated in Rewa, Madhya Pradesh. It has been inaugurated recently as well. Now, the next one is International Solar Alliance. It is a treaty-based international intergovernmental organization, which was jointly launched by India and France on November of 2015. During the 21st session of United Nations Climate Change Conference of Parties in Paris, France, it was conceived as a coalition of solar resource-rich countries, which lay either completely or partly between Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn to address their special energy needs. Now, what is the aim of this International Solar Alliance? That to lower the cost of technology and finance and thereby facilitate deployment of more than 1000 gigawatts of solar energy and to mobilize more than $1,000 billion into solar power by 2030 in member countries. Okay, so these are the objectives of International Solar Alliance. Okay, so that's it, everyone. If you have any doubts, please ask right now. I'll give you 1 minute to ask your doubts. Okay, now this solar energy is a key source of affordable and reliable energy, and it should play a significant role in achieving universal energy access. That is, it is a part of Sustainable Development Goal 7. Now, where is this headquarter? It is in Gurugram, Haryana, India. As of June 2020, the ISA framework agreement has been signed by 86 countries, with 68 having deposited instruments of ratification in this alliance. Okay. Everyone, please ask your doubts. Please ask your doubts. There is only one topic remaining. There is only one topic remaining. After that, I'll give you 2 minutes to ask your doubts. After that, we will end the stream. Please, everyone, ask your doubts. Now, the next topic that we are going to discuss today is Rogan Art, Gujarat. Okay, Rogan Art, Gujarat. Now, why was this art recently in use? Because centuries-old tradition of Rogan Art is facing an unprecedented challenge due to pandemic. Now, what are the key points regarding this topic? Is that the word Rogan means that oil in Persian, with origins in Persia. It came to Kutch around 3,300 years ago. This rare craft is practiced by lone Muslim families, the Khatris of Nirona village in Gujarat. Now, what is this technique? Okay. Now, Rogan is a form of textile painting which uses rich, brightly colored paint made from castor oil and natural colors. Castor is a crop commonly grown in Kutch region of Gujarat, and the artist sources it from local farmers. Now, what are the patterns in this Rogan art? The intricate motifs, geometric flowers, peacocks, the tree of life, etc. are drawn from the history and folk culture of Kutch region. Okay, now what is the process of making Rogan art? The castor paste is mixed with natural colors and then it is drawn out into a fine thread with metal stylus or column. This metal rod never comes in contact with the fabric. The artisans then carefully twist the paint across the cloth into motifs and patterns. Next, the fabric is folded, thereby printing its mirror image. The finer details are then added by completing the Rogan painting. Okay. Now, what is the recognition given to Rogan art? The Tree of Life design is a famous design in Rogan painting. It is inspired by traditional Persian designs. The Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi, gifted Rogan paintings to USA President Barack Obama during his visit to USA in 2014. The 9 artists from Khatri family have 6 national awards and 6 state awards between them. Okay. Now, what are the other important painting styles in India? Kangra miniature painting, which is in Himachal Pradesh. Pattachitra painting in Odisha. Thanjavur painting in Tamil Nadu. Kishangarh school of painting in Rajasthan. This is a well-known painting called as Bani Tani. It belongs to this style of painting. Next one is Kalamkari painting in Andhra Pradesh. Madhubani painting in Bihar. Varli painting in Maharashtra. Okay, so that's it, everyone. Okay, we have finished all the topics for today. If you have any doubts so far, please ask your doubts. After that, we are ending this class. Okay. That's it, everyone. Please ask your doubts. Okay, after that, I am going to end this session. I'll give you 2 minutes to ask your doubts, everyone. Okay. After the timing, ending this session. Please ask your doubts. Okay, everyone, I have given you ample amount of time to ask your doubts. Okay, so I'm ending this stream. So goodbye, everyone. Have a wonderful day. See you tomorrow.